The Vaiont Dam Disaster video. There was a thin but continuous clay layer present, which they had not observed during the geological mapping. But then, one piezometer always gave a high water level reading. They should have recognized this as evidence of confined groundwater, groundwater trapped at high pressure underneath the landslide mass. This goes to show how important it is for geologists to be well trained in hydrology, or to at least have someone in the team who is. We will continue with groundwater, section 3.15 on groundwater hydraulics. Steady unconfined groundwater flow between two fully penetrating canals as shown here. The aquifer is regarded as homogeneous and isotropic. Let's see what we can already figure out simply by reasoning. The boundary conditions at axis 0 and axis L do not change. That is, the hydraulic head at axis 0 remains H0, the hydraulic head at axis L remains HL. Therefore, the groundwater flow is steady or stationary. The steady flow is one in which the quantity of liquid flowing per second through any section is constant. In other words, continuity applies. The volume flux is constant. Q with a prime, that is Q in square meters per day, is constant. Now we can apply Darcy's law. Q with the prime equals minus K times the hydraulic head H times the hydraulic gradient dH dx. We combine this with the continuity equation and obtain this equation. Please note that for confined groundwater flow, the water flows through a constant thickness or depth d, but that for this steady unconfined groundwater flow, the hydraulic head H diminishes from left to right. As the volume flux Q with a prime is constant, the aquifer is homogeneous, thus K is constant, and H diminishes from left to right, the hydraulic gradient dH dx must become larger from left to right. As the hydraulic gradient is the slope of the tangent to the potentiometric surface in this cross-section, the distribution of the hydraulic head with distance x, the potentiometric surface, must have a convex shape. This figure is taken from Professor Charles Fitz's book Groundwater Science. When, as in most aquifers, the bulk of resistance encountered along a typical flow path is resistance to horizontal flow, we may assume that in a cross-section, the hydraulic head H varies with the horizontal direction X and not with the vertical direction Z in British English or Z in American English. With the Dupuit-Forchheimer approximation, the resistance to vertical flow is neglected. To the left, this figure shows actual two-dimensional groundwater flow, and to the right, groundwater flow modeled with the Dupuit-Forchheimer approximation. Please note the vertical equipotentials. This approximation is named after French civil engineer Arsène Dupuit and Austrian engineer Philippe Forchheimer. Following their approximation, and by assuming the hydraulic gradients to be equal to the slope of the water table, plus for small water table gradients, streamlines to be horizontal, Darcy's law and the continuity equation, Q with the prime is constant, can be combined to deliver the equation for the potentiometric surface for steady groundwater flow in an unconfined aquifer between two parallel fully penetrating canals with different water levels, as will be shown in a slide to come. For the Dupuit-Forchheimer approximation or assumptions to hold, as a rule of thumb, the length L of an isotropic aquifer must at least be 5 times larger than the average hydraulic head or average saturated aquifer thickness, indicated as D with a bar over it. The Darcy equation would then read as follows. Q with a prime, thus in square meters per day, equals minus K times the average saturated aquifer thickness or depth D with a bar times the hydraulic gradient I or dH dx. Simply by reasoning, when the length of the aquifer is much larger than the average hydraulic head or saturated aquifer thickness, we may take H0 plus HL divided by 2 as the average saturated aquifer thickness, and HL minus H0 divided by L as the hydraulic gradient. Inserting this in the Darcy equation and rewriting delivers the Dupuit-Forchheimer equation, an equation for the volume flux of steady groundwater flow in an unconfined aquifer between two parallel, fully penetrating canals with different water levels. We can derive this equation also in a mathematically sound way when starting off with the right hydraulic head distribution with horizontal distance x, that is the Laplacian for this specific flow case. This provides a general strategy that I would like to teach you for solving a number of groundwater flow problems. I will limit these to 7 groundwater flow cases. So I, or we, first want to mathematically describe the convex potentiometric surface for this flow case. This slide is also presented as Mathematics Toolbox 2 or M2 at the end of my book. Therefore, I will deal with it rather quickly here. Please note that Darcy's law is written as Q with a prime equals minus K times the hydraulic head H times the hydraulic gradient dH dx. The hydraulic head H is variable. It diminishes from left to right. Combining continuity, Q with a prime is constant, and the Darcy's law gives this equation, which we can solve mathematically using the chain rule as stated here. As a mathematician's trick, substitute h squared for y in this chain rule equation. This delivers dh squared dx is equal to 2h dH dx. Q with a prime is constant, K is constant, so H dH dx is constant. And we know this to be equal to half dH squared dx as stated here. So this is constant, we can divide by the constant a half and we obtain dH squared dx equals C1. When we integrate this, we get h squared equals c1x plus c2. This is the equation for the potentiometric surface for steady groundwater flow in an unconfined aquifer between two parallel, fully penetrating canals with different water levels. Because h is to the power 2, this equation is a parabolic one. Again, same as with the earlier case of confined groundwater flow, inserting the boundary conditions for known values of H0, L, and HL, first the left boundary condition for x is 0, H equals H0 to deliver C2, and then the right boundary condition for x is L, H equals HL to deliver C1, and inserting these values into this equation delivers this equation. Table 3.3 on page 136 in my book, giving the Laplacians or potentiometric surfaces for 7 groundwater flow cases, serves as a starting point to all groundwater hydraulics exercises. So please always start off by selecting the right equation from table 3.3. Thus far, we have dealt with 2 flow cases: steady groundwater flow in a confined aquifer between 2 parallel, fully penetrating canals with different water levels, and steady groundwater flow in an unconfined aquifer between 2 parallel, fully penetrating canals with different water levels. The starting off equations for these flow cases are as shown here. And we will extend upon these shortly to include 5 more flow cases. As already shown here, flow is in a 2-dimensional cross-section space, but 1-dimensional in the sense that it is regarded in the horizontal x direction only. Only for the leaky aquifer, also grouped under this heading, will we make calculations in the vertical z direction too, to calculate seepage through the leaky confining layer perpendicular to the x direction. Let's try to establish the volume flux through an unconfined aquifer between 2 parallel, fully penetrating canals with different water levels, starting, of course, by first of all selecting the right equation from table 3.3. The right equation is obviously this one, h squared equals c1x plus c2. First, you may find out the values of c1 and c2 by inserting the boundary conditions into this equation and then inserting the just derived values back into the equation as explained earlier. So we can think of c1 and c2 as having known values from now on. Taking c1 and c2 as known values, there remain roughly 2 slightly alternative ways to tackle this problem. From the equation h squared equals c1x plus c2, we can establish h as the square root of c1x plus c2, which is the same as c1x plus c2 to the power of 1/2. From this, we can determine dh dx by differentiation using the chain rule. First, differentiate c1x plus c2 to the power and 1/2 to give 1/2 c1x plus c2 to the power minus 1/2, and then differentiate this term between the brackets to deliver c1, and then multiply these 2, and you have dh dx. Now multiply the expressions for h and dh dx. We should always do this for unconfined groundwater flow, taking h and dh dx together, so to speak, as one term, because this one term is an inherent part of Darcy's law for unconfined groundwater flow, the Darcy equation. As we can see, conveniently, the roots in the numerator and denominator cancel each other out to deliver that h dh dx equals 1/2 a c1 and q with a prime equals minus k times 1/2 a c1. From inserting the boundary condition, we know c1 as stated here. Inserting this c1 gives the Dupuit-Forchheimer equation, but now as derived from table 3.3. Alternatively, and much quicker, we could have differentiated the Laplacian h squared equals c1x plus c2 to deliver that dh squared dx equals c1. Please remember from an earlier slide that the chain rule teaches us that dh squared dx equals 2h dh dx, and thus that h dh dx equals 1/2 a c1. Again, this will deliver the Dupuit-Forchheimer equation as end result. This slide shows us the problem of exercise 3.15.1.4, where we have a confined aquifer to the left and an unconfined aquifer to the right. As advice to make calculations for such a setting, a two-layer or two-aquifer problem, you will always need to account for continuity. As the boundary conditions are fixed, the volume of water flowing through the left aquifer per unit of time, Q left, equals the volume of water flowing through the right aquifer per unit of time, Q right. Please make the exercises of section 3.15.1, and the GO24203 students also the Blackboard individual exercise 3.15.1.5. Study well.